Thanks so much. I am so excited to be here today. And honestly, like just listening to all the lightning talks, I wanted to be 25 again. And can I be an intern on each of these projects? Doesn't it just make you excited to get up in the morning? All the things that we're doing and how new they are, and really the ability to every day do something that's never been done before and figure out how to do it and make it work. So. In talking today, what I thought I would do is talk about the work I've been doing on machine learning and causal inference. A lot of what we've seen today, I sort of cut out all my beautiful pictures. My slides are really ugly because all the pictures that I have are usually stolen from your guys' presentations like we saw today. And I'm just going to then assume everything's motivated and get down to the meat. But a lot of what we've seen today is still, it's new from an economics perspective, but it's bringing in predictive methods from machine learning. And so I want to talk about how to use machine learning to replace, augment, and improve what we can do in causal inference, which has been a big part of economics. So just as a little bit of advertising and overview, here are some surveys, and I'm happy to share the slides afterwards. I just recently wrote a paper called The Impact of Machine Learning on Economics for an MBER volume that is sort of my up-to-date view on how all of this is playing out. So everybody's welcome to look at that. And it's also on the AEA website. I just gave a course on machine learning and causal inference where all my videos, slides, R scripts, and everything are, and that paper as well, are up there. So when I think about the causal inference side, it's useful to start by just thinking about what is unique about cross-sectional econometrics versus other branches of statistics, to kind of think about what's different with machine learning and causal inference. And as I spent, you know, a long time working in the private sector, really the only economist in teams of machine learning people, I came to appreciate some aspects of what I learned in economics that were really unique and really helpful. So first, just the framework and language for causality. There were so many times when people would struggle to articulate what was wrong with something when economics kind of had a very clear language. So an example I like to give is, suppose you were trying to predict the occupancy of the hotel next door. You could look at prices on hotels.com. Maybe you got a training set from somebody counting people coming out, in and out. If you used a predictive model to predict how full is the hotel next door, high prices would predict that the hotel next door is full, not empty. And so higher prices predict higher occupancy. That is a success of a predictive model, but of course an utter failure of a causal model. If the question was, what should I raise my prices, you would need a completely different model to answer that question. And I've been continually surprised to see the shining lights and leaders and the most distinguished faculty in machine learning tangle themselves up about what is sort of 101 if you're a causal inference person. Another thing that we're very good at is not just the theory of causal inference, like, you know, drawing graphs or pictures, but actually how do we estimate it? How do we bring it to practice? What are all the supplementary analyses and measurement that we do? We also, in some parts of economics, build structural models to do counterfactuals for environments that have never been observed before. When I explained that to machine learning colleagues at Microsoft, many of them, once I finally convinced them that what I wanted to do was like, gee, what would happen if we change our auction model? I was accused of being, actually all of us, all economists, were accused of being non-scientists because, you know, if I was going to try to predict what something that had never happened before, how could you possibly do that scientifically? And occasionally we do need to make predictions about worlds we haven't seen before. But it's not about identification. So when people say, oh, it doesn't solve identification problems, I'm like, duh, of course it doesn't. You know, identification problems are about infinite data. But it can help us be much more systematic about model selection, and it can also just give us much better results. That is, I think of machine learning as like a robotic research assistant that can check lots and lots of specifications, and the robotic research assistant just does much, much better than any human research assistant ever could. And so the predictive parts that can be automated in that way just will perform a lot better. Just a few of the insights that we've been coming across, again, then just to sort of summarize the themes of this theoretical literature. We often modify the objective functions. We have alternatives to predictive mean squared error as the objective. So it might be heterogeneous treatment effects might be the objective, or predicting the change in behavior as a result of a change in price is another type of objective that you would use. The machine learning algorithms can sometimes be thought of deriving weights for more classical estimation, and that's a theme in my work on random forests. that random forests can actually be thought of a way to figure out how to do nearest neighbor type algorithms much better. The random forest tells me who should be nearby me, who should be compared to me. And actually in some of my recent work, we showed that any GMM model, any IV model, any type of structural model can be done in a local way using random forest weights. There's a big emphasis on sample splitting and cross-fitting to avoid bias. This is not a big theme in machine learning because people aren't thinking about bias or they're not thinking about standard errors or confidence intervals or anything like that. When you start to go into the statistical theory, it becomes important that you have consistent estimators and so on. You might want efficient estimators. And so what we've figured out in a lot of different settings is that you can do cross-fitting or sample splitting where you say you use the simplest cases, leave one out, you build a machine learning model on all but one observation and then apply it to that observation. And then the predictions that you use, you're never using the same data to create the model as you are to estimate your effects. I do that in our causal tree work in a very simple way. Half the data finds the subgroups, the other half is used to estimate the effects. That's super clear and very interpretable by people. It's been picked up a lot in the medical literature already and a lot of the field experiments literature. And then in other cases, when I'm building a random forest and I really want good predictions everywhere, I'm gonna continually subsample. I'm gonna build 2,000 trees. In each case, build the tree with half the data and do the estimates on the other half of the data. That actually turns out that just beats the machine learning models even most of the time, because it solves some of the problems the machine learning models had of overfitting the outliers and getting boundary cases correct. Then orthogonalization, it often turns out to work much better if you use them, at the beginning, if there's some covariates that are just sort of not really part of your main analysis, that you residualize everything out using a machine learning model and then do a simpler economic model on what's left. And that tends to actually also perform very well. And it makes your models a lot less sensitive to the details of the machine learning models that are being used. And then something I've been doing a lot of just in the last year is matrix factorization for panel data. I mentioned that before, and I'll show you, if I don't run out of time, a little example of that. I'm doing that both in structural models, so I'm building Bayesian structural models with my Bayesian co-author, David Bly, computer scientist, and I'm doing it in classical models, and that's the work I'm doing with Hito Imbens. And I think generally panel data models are gonna just explode because all of these big administrative digital data sets we have are panel data models. And machine learning actually is not as strong on panel data models as they are everywhere else. There's really a lot of room to improve. And I have some other work with David Bly where we're combining neural nets with Bayesian models that could then be used for demand estimation as an example. Okay, so then how much time do I have left? Is this keeping my time? Okay, great. I'm gonna give a little bit of a tour through this literature instead of trying to sell you one paper or one method. I actually wanna give you a little more of a sense of where you would look if you were interested. Hopefully I'll get you excited that you should go and look. And the way that I've organized this is to say, in the observational study and experimental causal inference literatures in economics, we have a whole bunch of different kind of methods that we've been using over the last 20 or 30 years. And basically now, each one of these, you could think of these are like entries on a reading list on an applied causal inference course. Each one of them, we are now having a new improved version of them. And I have entries in a lot of these. A lot of other people are putting entries in a lot of these. So this is I have to update this like every 2 or 3 months as more and more papers come out. And it's very exciting. The one big theme is that the old methods never win. The new methods are just strictly better in like almost every case for like good reasons. Okay, so the first one, average treatment effects under unconfoundedness. That's like basically I want to look at the impact of a treatment. I do not have a randomized experiment, but if I control for a bunch of stuff, the treatment assignment is as good as random. And so this one probably has by far the most entries in this box, a bunch of competing methods, and people are having contests and horse races, and it's kind of scary. I put up an algorithm, and then like the next week somebody's entering it in a contest, and it's a very active area. We have a bunch of different approaches. They all have the same most of them incorporate the same ideas though. That if what's important is that I control for covariates that are confounders. That's a different problem than a prediction problem. A confounder is a covariate that both affects and affects treatment assignment. And so if you just run a predictive model, you will tend to select things that predict outcomes, but you might leave out a big collection of weak confounders, that, and those are the things that you worry about from a bias perspective. If I want to know the treatment effect, I don't need to have the most accurate estimate of the outcome. What I do need, though, is to control for everything that would create bias in my estimate, because these are things that make people both get the treatment and have high outcomes. So we have a whole bunch of methods for that, and the one that I developed is called residual balancing. It's basically a version of double robustness, but we go out and use programming to actually do the weights rather than estimating a propensity score model. And a lot of these big data settings, I think it's not reasonable that you're going to do a good job estimating propensity scores and dividing by them. And so we basically show that you can get efficient estimates without ever doing that, because really the main goal is to reweight your observations correctly. And we just go after that directly. Then you get into kind of what stuff that's more, maybe feels more closer to the traditional machine learning. And that's conditional average treatment effects. So this is finding heterogeneity. And of course, I was very delighted to see applications of that in the lightning talks. So and I break this into two buckets. One I call moving the goalposts, which is basically let's ask a question about heterogeneous treatment effects. Let's use machine learning to figure out what some low dimensional heterogeneity is. And then we're going to get perfect standard errors on that heterogeneity. So I might have a 1,000 person field experiment. My causal tree method is going to use machine learning method, but put people into, say, 8 groups. Okay, and those 8 groups are going to be defined nonlinearly, but they're going to be groups. Here are the people who are high income, you know, urban, this amount of education, this kind of house. There's a group. And then I'm going to build that tree with half my data, and then I'm going to estimate the effects on the other half of the data. So then I will have perfect standard errors, because the standard errors are just about treatment effects within a group that has 100 people in it. So I know how to do that. There's nothing magical about that at all. I like that because it's very easy to get by referees. It's very easy for everybody to understand. And I also like it because it avoids some problems, some mistakes that people make in machine learning. If you run a lasso, there's a tendency to say, hey, my lasso selected X1 and X2, so they must be important. It zeroed out X3 and X4, so they must not be important. Of course, that's a terrible way to interpret it. It's exactly wrong, because lasso zeroed out X3 probably because it was correlated with X1 and X2, and it didn't add anything to the regression. But actually, X3 could be highly predictive if it was in there on its own, while the tree kind of at least forces you to think, these are the people that have these characteristics. It's a group. But I sort of know that if I see they're high education people, they must also be high income and everything else. And so, but it's hard to think about a regression because you're controlling for all sorts of stuff, and you have to know the whole variance-covariance matrix to really interpret omitted variable bias. But if I have a group, I can just look at the characteristics of the group and interpret it. I would say, though, for the moving the goalpost case, the key warning I would say is that don't think that just because my tree didn't split on parents' income, that parents' income isn't important. Don't just, my lasso zeroed something out. That totally doesn't mean it's not important. And you cannot interpret the things that are left as being kind of the only thing that's important. Instead, you should think about these models as kind of defining groups and then look at the characteristics of those groups, including the things that weren't split on in the tree or weren't included in the regression. Then we go to sort of a more fully non-parametric thing, which looks a little more like classical machine learning, just with a different objective. That's causal forest. And there we're trying to basically just say, for a particular person with these covariates, what is your expected treatment effect? And of course, that's useful for trying to figure out the question of optimal policies. So who should get what? Turns out optimal policies are not quite the same as heterogeneous treatment effects, related but slightly different problems. And there's actually been more work in machine learning on estimating optimal policies, especially on the causal side of machine learning. And I have a recent paper here showing how, if you have an experiment, how you would efficiently estimate who should get what policy in the end, especially if you have some restrictions on the complexity of your policy. Then we get to what I would think is the real drawing line between AI and machine learning. And this is the part that I think is super exciting, and I think development is just a great application of this. And if anybody wants to collaborate with me, call me tomorrow, and I'll be very excited to talk about it. In the end, when we're interacting with people digitally, we are able to not just run A/B tests, but actually do adaptive experimentation where we can get better and better. So I don't need to think about 5 arms. I might have 100 arms. I might have 100 different messages that could convince people to save or whatever. And I'm not really sure which ones I should use. The contextual bandits would say, I'm going to figure out a mapping from people's characteristics to the best way to convince them to save. It would take me 10 years to run a fully powered randomized controlled experiment to distinguish each arm from each other. But the point is, I don't need to distinguish each arm from each other. I just want to find the best thing for each person. So if I figure out that people like you are not a good match for this treatment, I'm going to stop giving them to people like you. And I don't actually care to distinguish the difference between the best two. I just want something that's really good. So this is a very powerful method. It's actually just on the cutting edge of what's getting implemented in tech firms. There's lots of theory about it, very few real-world implementations. I'm working on some with MOOCs and in a few other contexts and on Mechanical Turk and so on. But I think it's in 10 years, it's just going to be ubiquitous. And that's also going to mean that the economist is going to be an engineer much more than we used to be. Because if you're doing online experimentation, your experimental design and your estimation has to plug into somebody else's user interface. And so you really have to be integrating with the engineer. That's why you haven't seen many applications yet in the real world, because it's so hard to implement. Microsoft implemented MSN, and it took full-time employees of Microsoft like 2.5 years to actually get it in to practice. But like for me, I can use them in environments that I control, and that's what I'm trying to do. A few other things there's just to be aware of. Supplementary analysis, that's something that Hito and I have been pushing, that we can also use machine learning to do automated robustness checks and automated checks on the validity of your assumptions, especially in environments where you have lots of price changes or lots of small experiments. Instrumental variables, we've got machine learning versions of instrumental variables, GMM models, and so on. And then, as I mentioned earlier, large-scale structural models. So I do have to have some picture at some point. So, and by the way, all these slides are all available on the AEA Continuing Education website. So you can, not these exact slides, but this content is there. So just as a final like little advertisement for the Bayesian structural work, which I've presented less widely, is that you can write down a consumer choice model. You can use large scale factorized models to come up with individual price coefficients, individual preference coefficients. And then this is done using mobile location data. I can figure out that the willingness to travel or the willingness to pay for different categories of restaurants by different kinds of people is different at the individual level. So economics, I think, is going to be really just taken over by all of this. I think that we're not going to be able to publish papers without using modern methods within 5 to 10 years. It's going to be better. We're going to spend less time on research assistants, more time thinking about the actual identification assumptions and the substance of the thing. And hopefully we're going to have more replicable and robust results. Thank you.